Hello, YouTube. Liverpool fan in Japan here, the Miyazaki man, Sai. So who will win Euro 2024? It's already kicked off and underway. Lots of goals galore, but I think there are three clear favourites. England, of course, France, and Portugal. And luckily, our lads play for all three teams. We've got Diogo Jota, the slotter for Portugal, alongside Cristiano Ronaldo and Bernardo Silva. Keep an eye out on João Neves as well. Benfica wears the number 15. He is a wonder kid of the highest caliber. He could be coming to the Premier League, hopefully with Liverpool. And then we have Ibu Konate at France. It was his ball that released Kolo Randall Muani to have that chance against Argentina in the final, of which he fluffed. He'll never live it down. Ibu Konate, he's an absolute physical specimen. He could carry France's hopes, shielding the back line if he starts. And additionally for England, Trent Alexander-Arnold and Joe Gomez. I believe Trent will start the first game, and we will go into first game squad selection and analysis, tactical analysis on how England can beat Serbia and what to watch out for from the opposition, as well as how England will shape up as the group stages progresses as well. But before we carry on, this is international football. So as much as I love Liverpool and this is a Liverpool fan channel, I need to change into some international kit. And luckily, this just arrived today. Number 7, Shibasaki. I mean, this shirt is a few iterations old, but Japan Samurai Blue Pride. I'm going to wear it with style. Here we go. Gaku Shibasaki, who plays for Kashima Antlers. Proper midfielder. Okay, so let's look into England's setup against Serbia before we look at France and Portugal. And unfortunately, Virgil van Dijk with the Netherlands and Dominic Soboslai with Hungary, I don't think they've got the biggest chance to win the Euros. So monitor their performances as the Euros go on. So let's get into the formations. So I think good old Gareth Southgate has fallen into a 4-2-3-1 formation, especially because of the personnel he has at hand here. Basically, it is a 4-3-3, but ultimately, I think in international football, the wingers stay slightly deeper, but it suits the personnel that we have in mind, and they will be inverting as well. So I think it's pretty obvious. Certain names go in here. I think Mark Gahey has probably won the battle to partner John Stones, as long as he's overcome the injury and sickness. Kyle Walker, he's a supplementary centre-back, to be honest, because a left-back, he wants to go with Shaw. However, Shaw is a sick note and coming back from injury, so it will be Kieran Trippier, unfortunately, because I think Joe Gomez deserves a slot there. Could be wrong. I think certain midfielders are set in here, and Rice, being the deepest of the midfielders, allows this player here to really roam and cause damage. I'm just going to put his name in here right now because you know that Jude Bellingham will start in this position. The alternative is Phil Foden. Phil Foden is super effective here as well, but Bellingham is more central and more akin to a late box arrival in and off Harry Kane, because we know Harry Kane will go here off the top right at the start. Additionally, Bukayo Saka, as long as he's fit, I think Saka starts as well. There is a world where Eberich Eze could compete in one of the wide slots as well. And the big question mark is who partners Rice in midfield at the base here. Now, if it is as the base and we want to penetrate Serbia's back line, in that case, Trent Alexander-Arnold starts right here because it's ultimately our ball player. He is going to be our transitional player who gets the ball from back to front and help us dominate the game. And Phil Foden will always start. He'll always start because he is the wonderkind, the wonder kid. A great season at Manchester City. I think he's player of the year in the league, right? So this is the formation that we're going to go with. Ultimately, Rice was it here. Trent will operate in half space position here, the Beckham side position here. Walker will cover him like the intelligent shadow. Rice, I believe, will invert with Stones to hold the midfield to allow Trent that free roll, because Trent in here can deliver the balls in and around to Kane, out around the outside to Saka as well. But because Saka likes to cut inside into this kind of position here, the Mo Salah position, Trent can actually run himself down the line. Now here, whipped in ball to Kane, crossfield ball to Phil Foden, throws the back line, pull back for Aaron rushing Bellingham, cross the face of the goal to onrushing Harry Kane as well. I think Trent is going to rack up the assists, or the assist before the assist, the ball that releases the ball to get the assist to our players, because England have a great chance to overload the right hand side and make the threat from the left. When you have the ball on the right hand side, the threat is from the left. Harry Kane, Bellingham central, Foden for spillage as well. Rice to recycle, Stones to recycle, Trent, Saka in half space here. Super effective. He is basically a Mo Salah regen, except he hasn't got the goal scoring metrics yet, but he's still very young, so yet to be seen. Walker has the pace to track back and cover anything in and behind. You don't want to fight against Walker in a foot race unless you're Lucho Diaz, but even then the delivery wasn't good enough. Walker got back in place. Gay will be the one to cover for Stones. This will be a prominent position because he's athletic, he's pacey, and I think he can cover for Stones because Stones can recycle the ball. And against Inter Milan in that Champions League final, Stones was the ultimate player. You bop it, out it goes to Trent. You hit it to Stones, to Trippier, out to Foden. Stones will be the one that recycles the ball, and Rice can also be a late runner alongside Bellingham, Kane running into these lateral lines here, because the straight ball from Bellingham into Kane here goes there, can either go to Trent to Bellingham, and it goes, or Kane pulling back for Bellingham himself. So there's lots and lots of options and versatility, because the really beautiful thing about this England lineup
is the versatility of players to get into prominent positions, the delivery, and the many, many different ways they can hurt you. Bellingham is absolutely supreme at timing the run, a little bit like a Dele Alli, the prime Dele Alli, getting into the box and making his contributions count in terms of goal metrics. Trent Alexander-Arnold, his statistics are off the roof as well. Bukayo Saka, the wonder kid. In this case, it's not like a young Wayne Rooney where all your hopes on Wayne Rooney or the old guard. Literally, England have so many game winners. You've got your Phil Foden who will cut inside and cause havoc. Now he wants to sit in this position here, and it's just unfortunate we haven't got a bombing left winger like Andy Robertson. I know Shaw potentially could do it, but Shaw's a sick note and he might not start the game. I don't think he will start the first game. I think he'll be Trippier can deliver, but he's more akin to going on the right foot, so it'll be this kind of swinging ball, and it could be an effective swinging ball to Trent if Saka sits in this position as well. Walker, I think, will have a more reserved role. He won't be the bombing Walker up and down of old. He'll be like the Man City Walker of this current season gone. He will sit back and allow the other talent to do what they need to do. Now, it's very interesting that Foden and Bellingham can go behind Kane here, but Rice can also fill one of these positions. And this little quadrant here, Bellingham, Foden, Rice and Stones, is going to be how England build most of their success. But Bukayo Saka is a wild card who can pop up in the pockets. And Trent's delivery, I expect Trent to operate in this kind of quadrant here, to release the ball, to play the short ball, to play the transitional ball over to Rice, to Trippier, and you flood the box. Saka in and around as a wild card, similar to Foden, and I want Bellingham off of Kane. I don't want him too deep operating in deeper role. Now, there have been talks in the media that they think that Bellingham could potentially start deeper with Rice to allow Foden in this position. Now, what that allows you to do is have, for example, an Anthony Gordon, who is a willing runner. Goron. Anthony Gordon, willing runner all day long into the channels in behind. He's the only player, because Saka inverts like Salah, he's the only player I believe will run in and around the outside. You could have an Eze here, and Eze will be willing to run outside as well, but his penetrating runs and his ability to take the man on and not always go inside, Eze and Gordon would be the exciting old school option, in which case you really, really do sit your players in and around the position here for any spillages. There you go, Trent, pot shot. Bang. Tried to hit Harry Kane running in. Bellingham will try to slide in as well. Anything spillage? Foden, Trent and Bellingham. That's a game-winning triangle right here, because aptly backed up by Stones to recycle, Rice to cover and Gay and Walker to cover as well. That looks super effective to me. And actually, I prefer the Foden, Stones and Trent outside rather than Rice. I believe Rice will probably sit deeper. Probably more likely be Gay out there and Rice here, because of the fact that he can ball play from the back. Gay's athletic to defend the channels and whips. Walker's athletic to defend the channels and whips as well. So this is how England will probably set up against Serbia. Things to be wary of: Serbia will try to hit the long ball, try to counter-attack at pace, try to bypass the midfield as well, because England are particularly prominent in midfield with such good ball players, with Tekkers, Trent, Stones, Foden, Bellingham, for example, and Rice. Gordon could give the pace, but I don't anticipate Gordon starting. I think it will be Kieran Trippier. Eze is an excellent package off the bench as well, and if you really want a crosser, Jarrod Bowen is the one. And if you want to shut up shop, Kobbie Mainoo or Conor Gallagher will come on as well to shore up the back line. I do like Ezri Konsa as an emergency option at the back, and similarly Konsa and Gomez are very, very versatile, so they can cover the back line. No point in putting any keeper here, because literally it will be Pickford, that T-Rex. Okay, so let's look into how France will line up. We move on to Austria versus France. So Ralf Rangnick with Austria, obviously having rejected the Bayern Munich role to stay at there. He's got Baumgartner at RB Leipzig, probably the chief creative force there, probably his best player, right? What about Lima as well? Pretty good. Sabitzer, we know him pretty well as well from the Bundesliga. Little stint at Man United. So Austria will play a fairly familiar system that they've always played. Ralf Rangnick style of football, but with France, we're interested in Ibu Konate, and I think Konate does start. So let's go into Maignan at Milan. I think that's how you spell it. Koundé, most likely. Probably Hernandez on the other side, right? Hernandez, Ibu Konate. Man, Mountain Endo is proud of the weeb Konate. Talking to Kamehameha. Hupana in the back. I will probably say Upamecano, isn't it? I think France usually play with two destroyers in the back, in the midfield. So in the absence of really and true many, I think N'Golo Kante comes straight in, because Kante, what a player. He could really light up this tournament if he hits the player of old. And I think Camavinga out from the dark as well. Had a great season. Camavinga comes in as well. Now, what do you do up front? The old trusted formation of Giroud, Griezmann, Mbappe. Mbappe, I think, sat out one of the training sessions, but I think Mbappe starts, but he doesn't start centrally. In fact, Mbappe likes to play from the left, but I think Mbappe, will he play from the right? Then the other one is Ousmane Dembele, Will he play from the left? Will he play from the right? I think Mbappe probably wins out the battle of playing out on the left, which means Dembele starts here. They could switch at any given time. Griezmann, what a player. Literally, he was the most in-form player previously at the big international tournaments, and he was just snuffed up. It literally, I think he won like the Golden Boot and the Golden Ball best player and all that kind of stuff, which means you play off Giroud, because even though he's not as effective as the Giroud of old, my goodness, having this trio, Griezmann, Dembele, Mbappe, play off a front man who can hold up the ball and win you the game off a header or a scrappy little challenge, and these two clinging up France are indomitably strong as well, because Konate and Upamecano, they relived RB Leipzig backline of the past before Upamecano went to Bayern Munich and Konate obviously went to Liverpool. Big up Ibu. Konate can step through the gap as well. Upamecano is a ball player as well. Jules Koundé, pretty pacey, athletic, versatile, and Hernandez is a solid, reliable option here. Obviously Mbappe will try to cut in. He's a creative force, but Mbappe is very well versed. He is basically a prototype of a left wing version Nunes. Mbappe drilled the ball across to Giroud, chipped the ball across, chipped the ball to Dembele to make something happen, to shoot across. Griezmann floating in and around. Griezmann, I think, is the most prominent player in and around this position, the shadow striker, the Totti, Francesco Totti role, the Rui Costa role, right, the Pablo Aimar role. Griezmann is absolutely immense. Questionable character as well, that little transfer scuffle between Atletico and Barcelona. Who cares? Griezmann, as a footballer, is amazing. Silky divine. And I think he's got a few good years left in him to really light up the world stage. And obviously Mbappe, probably best player in the world. Always going to be a threat as well. He will just be freed up to do his thing because Kante and Hernandez working with Mbappe gives him the space. Griezmann could roam into the pockets in behind, which allows Mbappe to cut in and blast it, because his shot is amazing. His pace is amazing. He can shoot off both feet. And Giroud, he'll move out of the way or try and scuffle any rebound, and Dembele needs to be given the space to do his dribble jinky style to really, really dominate. Camavinga backing him up there. Koundé is the wide cover space. Konate, pacey, and Upamecano would probably sit there with Konate last man line at the back, because physicality and pace. And I expect England to beat Serbia 2-0, and I expect France to beat Austria 2-0 as well. Forgot to do the scoreline prediction for the England lineup, but ultimately I think France have an amazing chance to win this tournament because their strength in depth is absolutely scary. Literally, you could put Ferland Mendy from Real Madrid here. We're not even talking about Saliba, because Saliba could partner Konate or he could partner Upamecano, but I'm keeping Konate in there, even though I'd like him to have a prolonged rest to be fit for the new season. And Tchouaméni is fit. Obviously, you have the Real Madrid connection right there. You could replace Giroud with Thuram, who's been coming to form and lighting up again. And then you have Kingsley Coman, who can come in for Dembele as well. Similar type of player, very jinky, very upright, will go very, very direct as well. So there's a lot and lots of versatility, and Mbappe can Mbappe go wherever he wants, really. He's that good. And whilst I think the France and England squad are absolutely immense, because literally you can pull an abundance of players into this lineup, especially with France's midfield options and that attacking flair and attacking talent as well, they are absolutely amazing. Because you look at England's defensive options, right? Ezri Konsa, Joe Gomez, for example, in the midfield, Wharton. I guess up front, England's strength, you've got Ebrecha Eze, Jared Bowen, Ollie Watkins, Ivan Toney as well, penalty takers. It's hard to split them, but you'd probably favour France's overall squad quality, but individual quality of some of those players. You're talking a Harry Kane, right, who I think is a better version of Alan Shearer, a Phil Foden, and a Jude Bellingham. Jude Bellingham particularly looks like the type to me to light up a tournament, really announce himself. Trent Alexander-Arnold, Wonderkid, those balls and deliveries, no one in world football can replicate him at this stage. Kevin De Bruyne is ageing slightly, obviously he does it further forward as well, different type of player. You're only looking at De Bruyne and Trent Alexander-Arnold to really, really unlock the tightest defences from that type of ball as well. So the strength and depth of France and England is very, very strong. I think France just have the edge, but on a given day in the first 11, I probably would take England's first 11 over France's first 11. It'd be tight, and I'd probably put it just down to the fact that Bellingham off Harry Kane to me is so tasty. I think Foden might blow hot and cold in this particular England setup because it's not tiki-taka ball like Guardiola. So these are the options for France and England, but let's look at Portugal finally. I'm going to say it right here. I think this squad is just unfair. A little bit unfair. We're going to look at the first 11, right? And there is no real first 11. Ronaldo. Ronaldo. Okay. Rafa Leão at AC Milan. Now, you could put Diogo Jota. Jota the Slot is always worthwhile go, but it could be Bernardo Silva to unlock and release Ronaldo as well and to work those spaces in behind. Now, if Portugal were managed by anyone else but Roberto Martinez, but there was clear favourites, but I don't know, I have hesitancy around him winning the biggest of prizes. If you go third on, João Paulinho. So, isn't it? João Paulinho. And my boy, João Neves. He's that good that he starts for Portugal already, even though he's only, like, very, very young. And then, unfortunately, Fernandes. Bruno Fernandes. As much as he's a bit of a weasel, he's a quality player. His ball delivery and unlocking the door and goal scoring feats is amazing. Probably looking at João Cancelo, right? Still an attacking threat. Ruben Dias. Pepe is still a stalwart. Still going strong, Pepe. And Nuno Mendes, right? Wonder kid at left back. With Costa holding the line now. But literally, João Felix could go somewhere in here. Pedro Neto could go somewhere in here. Diogo Jota could go somewhere in here. Danilo, Ruben Neves, Mateus Nunes, Gonçalo Ramos could go somewhere up front. Gonçalo Inácio could go somewhere at the back as well. Diogo Dalot plays really, really well for Portugal, even though he's a mank. Silva is a wonder kid at centre back as well, and he could fit into the back line alongside Ruben Neves instead of Pepe, right? Portugal's squad is overloaded, so you've got the long-range attacking threat of Bruno Fernandes, right? But Ronaldo will drop deep in the pockets to try to get the goal. Rafa Leão will make the diagonal runs in as well. Bernardo Silva will float in and around, but ultimately Ronaldo is the target man and the most prominent goal scorer in history, really, alongside Pele. João Cancelo will bomb up and down the left. João Neves, intelligent shadow, holding the line. Paulinho breaking up play from central position. Diaz will probably be the one step forward because Pepe is going on in age, but Nuno Mendes likes to bomb up and down as well. So Nuno Mendes in this position here, Rafa Leão cutting it inside. He is basically the Lucho Diaz of the Portugal national team. Nuno Mendes is running in behind as well, and Bruno Fernandes picking up the scraps and pieces on this vertical here. But Bruno Fernandes can also sit on that vertical there. They will just look to give the ball to Bruno Fernandes. João Neves will hit the ball out to Bernardo Silva. Bernardo Silva will do his roaming role. Ronaldo comes in from the left as well. Leão can come in from the middle as well. Him working with Nuno Mendes is a tasty treat, and Cancelo will be given a free rein to do his thing because he ultimately can play anywhere in the pitch. He's that type of player. He is a Cicinho of the modern day. He's Dani Alves of the modern day. He's the Marcelo of the right hand side. Cancelo, in that title winning season for Man City, literally can go anywhere and do his thing. So this team is absurdly strong as well. They just don't have that much pace at the back. André Silva can come in for Pepe in that regard, but ultimately it'll be up to Paulinho and Vitinha and João Neves and Ruben Neves to break up the play in front of them and allow the attacking people to do what they do. And Ronaldo, when you always have a chance with Ronaldo up front, because I prefer Messi over Ronaldo, but Ronaldo is a supreme goal scorer and he'll always fashion a good shooting chance out of nothing. Rafael is a wonder kid, but he is a bit of a wild card as well, not consistent, but Ronaldo Silva, bringing that experience alongside Bruno Fernandes. You have Bruno Fernandes, Bernardo Silva, you're always going to create stuff anyway, right? And we have the wonder kid attacking talent of Nuno Mendes, João Neves, and Cancelo bombing up and down, and Rafael. Czech Republic don't stand a chance. They got a long ball to Suchek. That's about it. Suchek. Oh, yeah. The headed glory of the Fellaini, David Moyes style of play is a threat, but it's going to be 3-0. It's going to be 3-0 to Portugal, I'd assume. So, yeah. Who wins? Portugal, France, or England for the Euros? I still think that Bellingham just turns up on the day and you have that much talent in the squad. Who would you take between Harry Kane, Giroud, and Ronaldo? I'd take Harry Kane, to be honest. Even if it's Ronaldo, it's an aging Ronaldo, I'd take Harry Kane. Behind Ronaldo, who'd you take? Your Griezmann and Mbappe, your Bellingham, or your Bruno Fernandes and Bernardo Silva type of player? Well, Mbappe is obviously amazing, right? But I don't know, I feel Bellingham is really something special. He always pops up when you need him the most. So I'm going to put it equal between Mbappe and Bellingham. And they will be playing together next season, unfortunately, for Real Madrid. The allure is too good for that. You look at the midfield options. Rice, top notch as well. Who partners him would probably be a destroyer in the bigger games. But Trent Alexander-Arnold, if he comes up trumps and hits the assists, he could be retaining his place as well. Or he could put him in the back line and right back. But there's that narrative that you can't defend. It's BS. It's a system responsibility to defend. And when you've got Kyle Walker behind him, he's pretty secure, safe as houses. It's just that line behind the midfield and the defence where you need those options on the bench. And England, for once, have a huge array of attacking talent, right? You've got your Eberechi Eze, who can come on and work his magic. Anthony Gordon, pacey, in it, effective as well. No longer needing Darius Vassell, that kind of thing. just the squad depth of Portugal, regardless of Roberto Martinez, and that winning mentality of France and the dominance in the midfield that they can really bring about with Tchouameni and Camavinga, it's hard. But go on, England, bring it home. Go on, Gaza. Gareth Southgate representing. Wataru Man Mountain Endo, Liverpool fans in Japan, Japanese fans. We just want to watch good football, to be honest. We've got representatives in all nations, including right, Van Dijk and Gakpo, for example, and Solbeslayer, Domi Schlobbers. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. Make sure to subscribe if you haven't already. Lots of content coming out. I'll be doing the membership video next, what you can get for members. I'm going to be doing my review of the Anfield Agenda, what I really think of them in the members section, as well as translating Wataru Endo's book. The first part is coming next week. Smash a like on this video, help me get seen. Until next time, Miyazaki Man, Ichiban, Janet.